Hi everyone, my name is Marianne, welcome to my talk. I am UX designer at Voodoo in the casual team of Berlin, and I have now been working in the mobile game industry for 8 years. So I originally started off as a UI UX designer, but my career eventually shifted to UX only. In my career, I had the opportunity to design different genres of game on mobile, and I've always been used to working in pretty small teams. And I took care of many different aspects, and I really loved having an impact on the overall experience of the game rather than only the art. And so today I am here to talk to you about our game Plantopia. It's a free-to-play casual mobile game, and this is what we call a merge game. And our game is played 75% by women, and the average age is 27 years old. So this game is about Olivia, who finds an abandoned garden. So she starts fixing it up and planting flowers there. And then she starts a little organic product business. And so this game was created with the intention to bring something fresh and modern to the table for players. And that's why we chose to touch on topics such as sustainability, local businesses, building friendships, and also helping people. But we also wanted to create an innovative gameplay experience. But innovation in this industry can be challenging. So why is innovation in the mobile market particularly a challenge? So first off, how much innovation a player will be receptive to may actually vary across different audiences, but also context. So when we are talking about a casual mobile game, players are looking for a specific kind of experience. And our audience in particular, they have a busy life, maybe they have young children, a demanding job, and they're looking for something that can really get their minds off of things for a couple of minutes after work or in between breaks. So in our surveys, it has been shown that our players also have a lot of anxiety in their life. So they are specifically looking for an escape and not something that could add more stress in their life. And sometimes they might not even want to learn something new, and they might want to stick to something more familiar. And I would say, in general, the first-time user experience is a very fragile moment for a free-to-play mobile game, because mobile game can be played anywhere, anytime, so the player might not be giving 100% of their attention. They are also more likely to be in an unstable environment. So maybe they are watching Netflix at the same time, and they're also getting messages from their friends. And yeah, so we also picked the portrait mode because we also cater to players who actually appreciate being able to play with one hand. And finally, the player did not pay for the game. So if they are not very convinced by the first minutes, they are less likely to give it a chance. So if you want most of your players to get into a game, they should be able to do so almost mindlessly. You cannot let players getting stuck and having to figure out things out for themselves, because then a good chunk of them will simply give up. And so if you paid to acquire these players, you can't really afford that. So that's where innovation can get in the way. So if too much is new to them, it's going to require more focus or time on their end, and they might not be in the right conditions to give that to your game. So with this in mind, we can imagine how hard it is to find the right balance between new and familiar to create a success, and how to guide them smoothly through the innovative parts. In our goal, in our case, the goal was to make this game usable and enjoyable for an audience as large as possible, even to non-gamers. But first, I wanted to take a minute to introduce you to the merge genre in case you are not familiar with it. So at the moment, it's a trending genre in the mobile market, and the core mechanic is very simple. So the idea is to merge identical resources together in order to make it evolve to a higher level. And this mechanic can apply to any kind of theme. In our case, we pick plants. So here in the video is an example on how you can merge lemon seeds until you get a lemon tree. And what players like about this type of game is how calming and relaxing it is. They can really use this game to get the minds off of things. in most of the recent merge games that came out, there is also no win or lose state. So it's mostly based on completing tasks. So there is also a constant feeling of progression and productivity. And they can also control their session time because they can stop and they can pick up where they left off at any moment. So there is no time commitment that could potentially create stress or reduce the moments where they can play the game. So in what ways is Plantopia different and innovative compared to the other merge games? I would say that what makes our game different is because it's a combination of elements that we picked from several different game genres. So we have the merge core mechanic, where, as I said, the player grow plants, and then they have to plant it in the garden and wait until it's ready to be harvested to sell them. So we have a farming metagame similar to Farmville. And we also have some elements inspired from Animal Crossing. So traditionally, most merge games or casual games use an isometric view, but we use a front-facing camera with perspective and on a touch screen. It actually impacts the interactions with the environment. And then we also have a DIY crafting feature, which is another big point of innovation. So as you can see, there is a lot going on in this game, and combining these elements together meant that we would have to invent new ways to make them work together. So we also wanted to stay away from some frustrating aspects that we saw in other merge games. So first off, we have the energy system, where so completing tasks costs you energy. And so as a player, there is nothing you can do once you are done, except paying. So your session ends really suddenly, and we wanted our sessions to end more naturally by using different ways. Also in a lot of merge games, the player has a single board to merge with limited space. So the problem is as they discover more and more items, there is quickly a space issue. So players have to get rid of resources that may have a high value or may be useful later. So it's frustrating for the player, but also in terms of design, it limits the new content that can be added. So we made these choices, but it would also create some problems that we could not anticipate. So to avoid the space management issue and also have a more scalable system, we decided that there would be, instead of one game board, several game boards where you could find different types of items. So in order to grow plants, the player will have to gather different items across these boards. So to make a sunflower, you need a sunflower sapling from the greenhouse and some lights and gloves in the tool shed. But these design choices that we made meant that just for the basic loop, the player has to go to four different places. So they have to check the customer orders in the market. They have to collect the right ingredients in the boards, and then they plant in the garden and then return to the market to sell. And as the player progresses further in the game, the DIY crafting is unlocked, and it adds another layer of complexity to the game. The new boards are unlocked where you can merge your plants further to create new products. So as an example, you can merge your coffee beans to get an espresso, or you can process almonds to get almond milk. And then you can even combine these resources together to get a latte. So when it was designed, we already anticipated that it would be impossible for a player to remember what they're making, like what kind of resources they need, what they are supposed to find, all of this at the same time. So just looking at this chart, you can tell that the game might be heavy on the mental load. To help with this, design came up with the idea of pinning a recipe. So you could attach it to the top of the screen directly from an order or from a recipe book, and it would stay here on top no matter where you go, like a current objective, until you are done with the recipe. So the problem is this feature was invented. There are similar features in apps or in RPGs, but it doesn't exist in other mobile games. So we would have to teach this to the player from scratch. So the development of Pantopia started in April 2020, and I only joined the team in October, so the game was already quite advanced. And before I joined, there was nobody dedicated to UX, so there was quite a lot of issues. And as soon as the team had a prototype, they had been playtesting the first 30 minutes of the game almost every week, but the playtests were pretty chaotic, so players did not understand what they were doing, would get stuck for several minutes trying to figure out what they're supposed to do. And when I joined the project, our day one retention was 35%. So the team was really questioning these design choices and the viability of this game as a casual game. And the first months of my work on this game were mostly focused on fixing the first-time user experience, working with an existing tutorial, and fixing the usability. So yeah, we did many months of playtests. We tried very different things to fix it, and I organized them in different types of strategies. So some of them might seem pretty obvious. Some of them are actually mistakes, but I think it's still valuable to share this to you because they also show practical examples of best practices that you can find out there. So it's no breaking news for UX designers that you should not teach everything at once if you want players to understand and remember how to play the game. But even knowing this, when is the right time to introduce something is very subjective. Especially when you know very well how the game works, you have your own assumptions on what will be easy or not to understand. So even though our features were already introduced progressively, players were still overwhelmed. So we decided to spread the unlocking of our features considerably, and it would take almost double the time to unlock the same features. And this change really made a huge difference. So it was visible on the playtest, but most importantly on the data, because on this iteration, our day one retention went from 35% to 50%. I think a good starting point when you are designing a feature unlock is assuming that you are biased and that you underestimate how much you should spread these features, and eventually you can adjust later. And so it also applies when we decide to add new features to the game. So most of the time, you cannot just squeeze this feature in the middle of things. You have to reshuffle things. So when I want to introduce a new feature, I always look at playtests and data to find the best possible moment. So I think the classic flow model is also very useful as a tool to define when the player is in the right state of mind, to learn more complexity and welcome new features. So I find this interesting variation, the different emotions that people can feel when they are below or above the flow state. And if you look closely at the player's emotion during playtesting, they can be used as a needle to let you know if a particular feature should maybe arrive earlier or later in the player experience. So when they are leaning towards the security area, it's the best moment because this is when they are mastering things and they are start to complete actions faster, more automatically. But I wouldn't introduce it during the flow because this is what we are all aiming for when we are designing games. And I wouldn't also introduce it when it seems like they are getting bored because they might already have churned before. And our game was available on the App Store, so we were able to acquire players and could always combine this qualitative data that we have with quantitative data to see if they confirm each other. So by simply tracking the steps of our funnels, we could easily see the steps where we were losing more players than usual. And of course, we were looking at the moments, which levels they would churn. So, you know, a spike of a player churning when a new feature was introduced was a sign that maybe this is too overwhelming. And also an increasing trend of churning could be a sign that they are getting bored. Of course, if we didn't introduce any challenge here. So one of the other changes that had the most significant impact in the success of our tutorial was really to channel the player's attention by removing anything else that can take away their attention from what they are supposed to do. So as an example, originally our board would display a bunch of locked items. So they would just start interacting with everything as if they didn't really have a clue if they were really going in the right direction. And then we added weeds that disappear when you merge next to them. So it would progressively discover what is on the board. So not only was it better to focus the player's attention, it's also a lot more satisfying, and it gives a sense of discovery, progression. So hiding the distractions can also be done in a playful manner for the player. So we have been applying this principle to many other aspects of the game. We made a lot of secondary menus hidden, and we unlocked them later, because even though it was not a complex feature, maybe it could be perceived as one. And also sometimes, looking at the footage, we were really baffled at how important things were going on the screen, and players didn't notice them. So I'm thinking it could be linked to the limitation on visual acuity, because we didn't really realize that it could be an issue on a small phone screen. So one example of that is that how players, even though they had gathered every ingredient they needed to plant, they didn't notice that it could already plant, and they would keep merging things on the board that they didn't need. So they could not progress in the game. And it's maybe because they were focused on the middle of the screen and the pin is placed at the top. So one thing that helped, we're adding a lot more visual effects. So now when the player gets one item that is needed for the current objectives, I'll see a particle go to the top. And once all the items are gathered, they have a big celebratory message displayed in the middle. And similarly for the market orders, so our players didn't really react to the customer orders that were ready to be sold. And since it's part of the basic loop, so it was really crucial to make players complete this step. So similarly, we doubled down on the VFX with a really obvious tooltip, floating with the customer space. And interestingly, players still ignored it until we added a check mark to it. So it shows how even small details can make a big difference, and how also a VFX isn't really relevant if you don't really attach a meaning to it. So one of the main problems of our game is about the mental load. So one of the strategies we tried to alleviate it is implementing some automatic behaviors that would help to remove some of this mental load. So if you have played a match three game on mobile, you might be familiar with this green play button in the bottom right. It takes you to the gameplay, and some merge games use it too. But since our players didn't know what to do in the game, designers decided to use this familiar button that would do the thinking instead of them. So no need to really navigate between buildings, it would take them to the right place immediately. So you have a chart here of how the button would behave depending on the situations. So we tested it and it worked. People would intuitively tap that button, but the benefit of this button was actually very shallow and confusing for several reasons. So for some players, as soon as they unlocked another board, it became useless. They didn't know how the button behaved, and they started immediately navigating manually. And also, the lack of control didn't feel good. So it doesn't matter if the button acts in a rational way. It's very important to give your players the freedom to be irrational and maybe take the longest route, because this is not how they perceive things. And also all the players who actually relied on this button, they would no longer know what to do when it was required of them to think about where to go, because they never really thought about it. So in our case, it was preventing players to understand how the game works, and we actually really needed players to think here. So an automatic behavior might seem like a good idea on paper, but it's actually pretty dangerous. So as a general rule, I would advise against using these automatic behaviors. But I did find one example where it has been useful for us. So when the player pins a recipe, they might miss a resource that would require them to pin another recipe. So for example, here on the left, you can see that to create a yellow bag, you need yellow coloring. But it's very tedious to do it manually in the recipe book. So it would cause them to forget about the initial objective. So we added a feature where they could pin the missing item directly from that recipe. And once it's completed, the initial recipe comes back again to the foreground. So when is it really relevant to add an automatic behavior? So I think it's safe to say that it's very risky to have them for anything that impacts the strategy or takes decision for the player. It's also not something I would use when the player is really learning the loop and the logic. However, it can make a difference in your player experience if it can help them stay in the flow or stay on track with their objective. But it should only be used in cases where you are sure about your player's intention and if you are sure that this is what they will want to do next. And coming back to the pin, it was a good idea, but the problem is that since it was new, players did not understand the function of the feature. So we did explain it in the tutorial, but as you know, players may not read the text or simply forget, so it wasn't enough. So I did two things to fix it, and the solutions were also quite simple. So first, I was inspired by puzzle game tutorials, and so I added a step where instead of presenting it as something that the player can use, I clearly state this as the player's objective. So in this case, taking inspiration from other games has been useful. And I think before that, not only did we not draw enough attention to the objective, I think we tried to make our tutorial blend too much with the storyline for the sake of immersion, meaning that sometimes the actual instructions can become blurry. And despite this, sometimes players didn't really grasp the concept of pinning, so they would just repeat this word in confusion. And one was wondering if it had anything to do with Pinterest. So here I simply changed the verb from pin to prepare. So instead of describing what this feature does, I replaced it with the practical action verb. So there is absolutely no ambiguity. When the player presses this button, they make the decision of working on this recipe. Another classic issue that we had with our game is that despite explaining everything in the tutorial and making the player successfully complete each step, not all players would have really remembered or have paid attention to the tutorial, and they would get lost once they had to be independent. So while I think it's a very necessary step, it's useless to extend it. It would only make the player crazy to have zero control in the game. But leaving the player without any guidance, it's also not an option. We did have some hints being triggered, but it was not sufficient, or it was even frustrating or misleading. So I kind of had to restart this from scratch. So I designed a system of hints that would be triggered under certain conditions. So unsurprisingly, the first condition is the period of inactivity. And then I have a list of priorities to display the hint that is the most relevant or natural to display next in relation to the player's current objective. And this system is designed to evolve with the player's skill level. So for the first hour of gameplay, everything is active, but the delay will increase. And later it's going to be deactivated. Otherwise, players will get very frustrated that the game would not let them think for themselves. And then what I call a passive help, so it's what the player can actively seek. So one of the complexity of our game is that it has a lot of content. So we have tens of different recipes, we have hundreds of different items, and it can come from different places. So for each required resource, if they don't remember how and where to get it, they can always access this help pop-up where they'll get all the information that they need. And I have been able to observe that this pop-up really became a pillar in the game for new players, but also for players who came back after not playing the game for a while. And it's also working because we've made it easy and quickly to access. So if we decided to show this information in a separate menu where they would have to go back constantly, it would have been a real pain for them and a potential reason to give up on the game. So today, even though there is still room for improvement, thanks to all of this, we have come a really long way, and we no longer observe players getting stuck in the first hours of gameplay anymore. And we've been able to start scaling up the game finally and focus on adding events, new features, new content. So I think if there is a lesson that I learned and I would want to share, I think this quote sums it up quite well. And it would be that even though your game might seem too complicated, it is possible to turn it into something very usable for a large audience. And there are as many solutions as there are problems. And some of them are quick and more simple than we think, like a change of wording an icon. So grasping the root of the problem can be really hard. And sometimes you actually understand what it was after it was solved, which is why playtesting on a regular basis, iterating and using different types of approaches is so important. So that is it for today. Thank you very much for giving me your attention. If you are facing similar challenges, I hope that my talk will be helpful for you. And I will be happy to answer any question. If you want to connect with me, feel free to do so. I can easily be found on LinkedIn with my full name or on Twitter with my username Tissos. Have a nice day and enjoy the rest of the conference. Bye.
All this is possible thanks to our sponsors, Playtest Cloud, Player Research, Balsamiq, Adobe, the book, How to Be a Games User Researcher, UX is Fine, Antidote, and Sketch.